So bye-bye.
Bye. Yes. Thanks, Gideon. Yeah. So very excited to be here to talk about microlearning. Robyn's going to share her screen here in a moment, and we're going to go ahead and get started and give you some information that we think is really critical when you start to think about designing, developing, and delivering microlearning. Robyn?
Absolutely. Well, welcome, everybody. I'm just trying to get a little bit of an adjustment here because it's not allowing me to do both screens at once, so I apologize. Yep, that's what I thought. Okay. bear with me. And now I've lost both. Okay. Well, welcome everyone. As Karl said, my name is Robyn Defelice, and Karl and I are going to do a little presentation here on the what, why, and how of microlearning. Some of you may have these questions. I think it's a great foundation for the rest of the awesome presenters that are also going on today. Kind of spark your brain a little bit here. I see that as we did some of the, you know, as I popped in, I see that we were having our brains sparked by a very innovative and entertaining individual. But I thought we'd get some formalities out of the way first. And so, Karl, I don't know if you wanted to speak to your slide, or I can gladly present you if you like.
No, that's okay. I think Christopher did a great job. So yeah, I'm a professor of instructional technology. One of the cool projects I'm working on right now is on YouTube. I have a series called The Unauthorized Unofficial History of Learning Games, which is a lot of fun. And I recently founded something called the L&D Mentor Academy. If you're interested, you know, Google that or email me and check that out. I think that's all we need to know for today, though.
Awesome. Thank you. And I will say without bias that the unofficial history of learning games is actually really cool. I enjoy listening to Karl's information. It's all these things you don't know. And then you're like thinking about the game you played with your family last night and its origins. And it's kind of fun actually to think about that. For myself, Robyn Defelice, I am a learning strategist and collaborator with many fine folks across tons of different industries. I do microlearning design and mentoring with LXD Launch. And I also do a lot of contributions and authoring of articles guided towards learning leaders in the L&D space for Learning Solutions Magazine, focused mainly on microlearning. So, you know, segueing off of the final bullet point here, Karl and I wanted to share with you some answers to some of the most common questions in microlearning, which is the, you know, the format and title of our presentation. And so this is to help those that maybe have already embarked on the endeavor or those that are considering it for the new year as part of their learning initiatives. So some of this will get you started in priming the pump or maybe validating what you're doing already. So I'm kind of going to throw it back and forth. Karl and I decided we just wanted to talk to you all today and kind of share some things. And I really kind of wanted to prime and ask Karl here, you know, how do you help others learn about what microlearning is and is not? Because Karl and I have different ways about going about this. So we thought we'd share a little bit about what it is and is not. And so Karl has some ideas, and then I do as well. So Karl, I think you wanted to play some games just as much as we saw some participation going on a moment ago.
Right. So I put in the chat a link to a game. I want you to go ahead and register as a player. And it's called Factor Fishy. And it basically is an introduction to some microlearning. And I want you to get some thoughts there about what you think about microlearning and how microlearning works. Oh, I might have put the wrong link in. I've been looking at a number of different links. And so, no, that one is prediction for the new year. So that's a bonus link for everybody that wants that one. So if you want to know what's going to happen in 2022, you can click on that link. If you want to play the game, click on the new link. And so just take a few minutes to go ahead and do that. It's basically a card game. So you drag it and drop it. And that's all that you need to do there.
I was going to ask if your link was fishy and not fact.
Right. The first one was definitely fishy.
I do like this game, actually. I think it's a great tool.
Yeah. It is not a phishing scam. that's a great pun, though. So give everybody a moment to go ahead and play that game. And when you come back, what I want you to do is just put your score into the field there. And then all the things that we talk about in this presentation are going to be related to that particular learning experience. Now, as Zolt says, it's not about, taking too long to load. So, let's just move on then as we go through. I wonder what's going on with that. Okay, so Robyn, let's go to the next slide and we'll just kind of move right along.
Okay, I wasn't sure if you wanted me to grab it and maybe share it and see if we could get it to go.
Well, it seems to be having a little bit of a, I don't know if it's server overload or what might be. Actually, if I could share my screen real quick.
Sure, go ahead. Do I need to stop?
Yes, please.
There we go. I mean, with over 1,000 and some folks at this conference, I could imagine blowing out your server.
Here we go. So let's go ahead and play a quick game. So we'll click this on. Microlearning should be part of your learning strategy and not an entire strategy for learning. Robyn, do you think that's a fact or fishy? And what does the chat say?
I think it's fact. Oh, my God. Okay, now he's testing me.
Yeah, that's fact. Right. So if you have used a YouTube video to change a faucet, you've used microlearning. Is that fact or fishy?
I'm going to go fact.
That is a fact, Robyn. You're very good at this. To create microlearning, all you need to do is chop up a long recorded session into little chunks, and then you're good.
No, totally fishy. I knew it the moment you said it.
Wow. A lot of people like to do that, though, so it's not always that good. Research backs the use of microlearning, Robyn. Is it research-based?
I do. I believe it is research-based and evidence research-based, right?
Well, it is. Yeah. And in fact, the research for microlearning goes back literally over 100 years, the Ebbinghaus forgetting curve. So pensive microlearning, a kind of microlearning, is when a participant reflects on an idea, situation, or task. What do you think of that?
I'm going to say fact. I pensively thought about it and I say fact.
That is a fact. Robyn, are there 25 different types of microlearning?
Oh, my God. There's probably more than that.
There might be, but we've only identified six in our book.
Oh, so, okay.
So we're going to have to call that fishy, right?
Fishy.
Can it be microlearning be an effective aid for learning recall?
Yes, fact.
I think so. That's why we're all here. That's what it does. The value of microlearning is in the small, concentrated instruction that it provides.
I'm going fact here again, too.
I think that's a fact as well. And then, okay, we're almost done. Microlearning must be no longer than 5 minutes.
That's total fishy.
Hard stop. Okay, that's interesting because a lot of people, Robyn, think that microlearning is time bound.
You know, that's interesting. I mean, I do understand that people do think that because I think the word micro gets people thinking that it's time bound. But depending on the topic, you know, what was it? Fixing a faucet or a shower head? That might take you, it might take you 10 minutes. That's over five right there. I don't know.
I don't know
any homeowner that can do a faucet in less than five. I'm impressed.
No, definitely not. Okay, the last one, I'll do that as a gimme. Humans will forget information over time. That's pretty much a fact. And I feel like I'm a living exemplar of forgetting information over time. So that really is kind of where I fit. So let's go ahead and go back, Robyn. I will stop sharing and go back to you sharing. So thanks, everybody. Sorry about that little error. We don't know what happened there. So let's go ahead and go to the next slide.
Absolutely. I actually enjoyed that. So, you know, given the facts and the fishy, what really is microlearning? What it is, what it is not. And here is what we would call the more academic technical term. But when Karl and I created this term, it was because we synthesized multiple definitions of microlearning, some of which included must be a certain amount of time or it must do certain things. But we really distilled it down to the foundational elements that make for effective microlearning. And so here it is on screen. It's generally an instructional unit. Usually think like one learning objective. If you're LMS focused, you can think of it like a SCO. And you know, it has a short engagement. We just did a short engagement, right? And it was in an activity and it elicited a specific outcome. That outcome wasn't that we could answer fact or fishy. The outcome is that we have a better comprehension of what microlearning actually is and is not. So that's where, we get our definition from microlearning, and then we have some other examples that we can show. So Karl's game is actually a microlearning item or product, as we like to call it. But I wanted to give you an idea of some other microlearning products too. So there's another piece of what is it, what is it not. Many folks think that it's only mobile technology. What you see on screen here is two different types of microlearning. One is actually a poster from a recent conference that was held in a physical space. And this little poster is actually a piece of microlearning, whether you realize it or not. It's a short instructional unit, one learning objective, that objective being to educate you on the wristbands and the color of them. That outcome that's being held is a behavior. When you are walking around the conference space, you are being mindful of other individuals' comfort levels and how they want to engage. And so other things that individuals may have done is taken a photo of that poster. They might have started looking around the conference area to see who's got more red than green than yellow, that type of thing. So that is actually microlearning in a one succinct way happening just in the moment, highly contextualized. The one to the side of it is a piece of microlearning that's more effective domain. It's about behavioral change and it's about active listening. So here we have a application of an authoring tool. It's actually in 7 tabs and it was produced by one of my students in the LXD launch courses that we did. And I thought they did such a great job and it makes for a great example of how powerful microlearning can be. So we saw a great tool that Carl has that helps us to start to dispel maybe myths, or we can use it for flashcards. Here we had an example of a poster in the moment. But we might imagine a series or a microlearning campaign, which would be multiple products, microlearning products, set up and stylized in a way to build you up on a skill, attitude, or behavior. And so we can imagine that Carl and the art of active listening is part of a series of soft skills around the techniques of being a better active listener as a leader. And so this product, as you can see, is a real quick, simple piece. It's available for you via your laptop or even over mobile. And you can see you can pop through this. You can listen to a story audio based. So now we're starting to see a blend of things that come together for microlearning. I realize I'm not actually showing that on screen and I'm sitting here showing it to myself. So I apologize, but I can actually give you the link too and put it in the chat so that you all can take a look at it as well if you would like. So that is a piece of microlearning too. Now let me just pop over here and give that to you all. And then I'll go back to our presentation. What I really like is that it's kind of like limitless what you can do with microlearning. Some of the things that I showed you, maybe again, the poster wasn't common, but it definitely gives you a sense of that. Now, we've given you the what it is, what it isn't. So you can see the benefits, right? You see them coming already. Your mind's already turning about them. Maybe you already have put some things in place so you know that they're beneficial. But for them being beneficial, it seems so challenging to incorporate them. So that's the thing. There's this blend of, I see their value, but then when I try to put them in, they don't always work. So Carl and I have experienced this with folks that kind of got burned on microlearning. So we want to take into consideration the value that can be derived from its incorporation. So I wanted to share a little bit about that and talk to you about what are those values. Are you thinking about the fact that the value of microlearning might be that it's a short time burst, so you can put it right in there and deliver it anywhere, like we saw, or deliver it in a very highly contextualized place like a conference, or there's less interference when you are doing these quick little sound bites. Or the value is the fact that you get to dial in on something that's very important. So if you don't need to teach everybody the whole entire series of something, but just need to focus on one select item, you have that ability to focus on that. The other thing is you get to make them highly personalized, because if you don't, they lay flat and they don't have that effect of that eliciting the behavior you're really seeking from your participant. And then we like to do, and I know one of the next speakers coming up always advocates for this too. Carlin has talked about this, and I love when she brings it up, at the point of need. So putting that microlearning right where the participant needs it. So whether or not they're engaging in it to take care of a client or a customer on the phone with them, or they're about to walk into a sales presentation and they need to, you know, brush up on something. That's the great beauty of microlearning. So, with all that being said, Karl, I know you have dealt with some challenges around microlearning and incorporating it. Would you like to talk a little bit about what some of those challenges are?
Yes. But as I do that, Robyn, one of the questions in the chat was, what's the difference between a job aid and microlearning? Any thoughts on that?
So you, I guess they're both at point of need. I don't know if there is semantically a difference. Some days I struggle with that myself. It's one of those things where you are selecting your performance in an informal way. It's not necessarily tied to performance growth or development or even the recall. I think, Karl, because I was just listening to your podcast the other day, weren't you explaining it as it's not necessarily that you're remembering how to fix the faucet? I think that was your example in the podcast I was listening to.
I think it's a little bit, to me, microlearning is more of a strategy. A job aid is a tactic. Right. So we want to provide short bursts of information over time or at the point of need. That's kind of our strategy. Right. And our tactic would be a job aid or a small video or a card or something that's digital. So I view them as related. But when we think about microlearning, I think of it more of a strategy. Right. So what's the strategy? Well, we want to focus on a goal. We want to implement maybe this strategy without We can't implement without considerations of bandwidth or without considerations of resources. We might not know initially what those resources happen to be or how they work, but we want to think about that as a part of implementation. Then we want to think about the styles, right? We don't want to just be digital. The job aid is a physical manual style. We might want to use a phone. We might want to use a poster. We might want to use all those kind of things. I think the important thing is that, to Jordan's point, wouldn't a job aid be more just in time and reference based? Yes, but microlearning, we identified six different types of microlearning in our book. And so one of them is just in time, but one of them's also learning over time. One of them is reinforcement. One of them is pensive microlearning. So there's different types of microlearning. One of the problems I think that we get into the learning and development industry is we call everything learning, right? But learning to tie my shoe and learning to do brain surgery, two different things. It's rumored that the Eskimos literally have dozens and dozens of words for snow. But here in Pennsylvania, I've got one word for snow, whether it's wet snow or light snow or heavy snow or whatever. And I think part of the confusion in our industry about microlearning and learning in general is we don't have specific words. And so that's why I think that it does make a difference when we think about the different kinds of microlearning and just-in-time microlearning is different than pensive microlearning, which is different than a preparatory microlearning or post microlearning. All those are different kinds of things. So great question. Thank you, Jordan. So we want to think about pushing the timelines just because, the last thing I want to say is just because it's micro doesn't mean it takes less time to do it, right? If we don't think through it, if we don't view the microlearning as something in and of itself, or we just chop up a course, then yes, of course it's going to be faster, but it will lose its context and it will lose its meaning a little bit. Robyn, do you want to add on to that?
Well, I think the question came at the right time for the slide that's in front of us and the next slide that we're about to discuss as well, Karl, because I know you wanted to talk a little bit about the learning ecosystem. But to your point, a job aid isn't necessarily focusing on a goal other than to support the individual in their job performance at time of need. But if we just run around doing support in that manner, we're not necessarily thinking strategically about how microlearning as a method or an approach can actually help with performance improvement or performance refinement or performance growth. There's all different ways in which we can look at microlearning. And that kind of brings us to this slide, Karl, because I know one of the things I really appreciated when we first started working on this and talking about microlearning is how you saw it as a method and a philosophy in which you can incorporate it into your learning ecosystem. And it complements and sometimes is some of the other things that are sitting in your learning ecosystem, to Jordan's point, the job aid.
Exactly. When we think about learning, sometimes we think about bolting things on. Sometimes same with games, right? A game becomes, you know, something that we just kind of bolt into the curriculum. But basically, we need to look at the whole learning ecosystem of our organizations or our clients or whomever we're dealing with. and we have to devise the elements that fit in properly. So microlearning can both be done before we do a typical e-learning or a webinar or a face-to-face classroom, but it can also be done after. It can be even incorporated into that. It can be part of job aids. It can be part of instructor-led training. So what we really need to think about is the entire ecosystem or an entire construct of where we want to add that kind of learning into it. And the main thing we need to focus on is the outcome. What performance do we want the participant to be able to do when they're done with our microlearning, right? So maybe it's just input a piece of information. Maybe it's just identify whether I should hug you or give you a high five or stay away. Maybe it is a step in a longer process of learning about product integration or something like that. But what we really want to focus on is what is the outcome that we want from the learning experience. And oftentimes we get that, you know, if you look at, Simon Blair talks about, you know, we need to give Hollywood, you know, as much time to microlearning as Hollywood gives to their movie trailers. Of course, Hollywood makes a lot more money on their movies than we tend to make on learning. But the idea is that that attention to detail about what the learning outcome should be needs to be there, right? We need to think about that kind of element. And when we do that, then it fits into the broader picture. Like, so Hollywood doesn't just do trailers, they do commercials, they do talk shows, they do email, they do websites. They have a whole system or campaign to get you to that movie. We should think about having a whole system or campaign to get people to the performance outcomes that we're trying to accomplish. So that's the element here from this particular point, Robyn, and I think we're starting to get a little close on time. So let's move to the next slide.
Okay, so this ends with how can we get L&D departments and professionals having success with microlearning? So some of you might be going, okay, well, I think I'm doing microlearning, maybe not, but I want to think maybe more strategically. And so these are some of the ways in which we would want you to focus on doing that and building success for yourself. And this is, you know, based on Carl and R's experiences and working with clients or helping to consult others. But with microlearning, you kind of heard just over the last couple of slides, this takes time and you need to plan. You need to plan that strategy, that campaign. Think of a marketing campaign, as Carl pointed out, for a movie. That's what you're kind of doing here. How are we building that performance over time? KPIs are not measured by the day, they're measured over time. And that's really what you're attaching to. Not only do you need to have that upfront time and planning for development and implementation, but you also need the talent to go with it. I can tell you from personal experience of training others in microlearning design that sometimes we rest on our laurels of e-learning development to push us through. And you quickly learn that maybe those aren't necessarily all the skills you need, or you need to dial in or refine your skills. So that's part of it. But then the other part is there's a lot of performance data and other things that you might need, such as the marketing department, as we just described. So there's sometimes skills and talent that we need outside of the L&D department that we typically don't rely on when we're really trying to do impactful microlearning campaigns and strategies. And then the resources. Sometimes we have systems in place and we really rely on our LMS for everything. We've just heard multiple ways in which we can engage a person in a microlearning piece. And therefore, sometimes you need other technologies, such as just email campaigns and open and click-through rates, those types of things. So that's some of the things you need to consider to keep yourself successful in planning and utilizing microlearning for your organization. To take one more deeper dive on microlearning and the skills, you have to think of it in these ways. If you're really thinking about that methodology and strategy Carl was just talking about, you need to focus more on a performance-driven design. So we're not telling and talking at you and you're checking a box and saying, I've completed. We're thinking about this holistically. And when we're talking about performance and behavior change, that's a multi-scaled, multi-tiered need and issue. And therefore, a lot of times we need change management to go with microlearning. It might be totally different to the culture of your organization to even do something that might be more performance driven. And then finally, as I was talking a little bit ago, microlearning design principles, you need to have concise writing, meaningful context. It all has to just draw and engage you, much like the things that we've done in today's presentation. They were all to draw you in and engage you on the topic solely and specifically of microlearning. So with all of that being said, how can you get started with microlearning? Karl, do you want to take a beat here and share with them what they can do?
Yeah, absolutely. So the first thing is, you know, start with the end in mind, right? The old Stephen Covey phrase. We have to assess our immediate and our strategic opportunities. What are we trying to accomplish? What do we want the people to be able to do? So once you've established that, then you want to build your case. You want to find out, well, what kind of microlearning works best? Should I have the learners reflect? Do I want to do something like a job aid? Do I want to do something like a poster? Do I want to do something digital? Do I want to deliver it on the phone? Do I want to deliver it to their computer? Both. So those are kinds of elements that you figure out. Then you want to look at building the case. Are you going to help move that performance forward with your microlearning? And then you map it to any kind of campaign and related products that we already talked about, because that's really how you make this happen. Then this is a point many people skip, is you want to design a sample and have the sample evaluated. Lots of times, or sometimes people will create learning, microlearning, and not create a sample. And maybe it doesn't quite resonate or doesn't quite hit. If anybody's seen the Miss Excel on TikTok, you know that she presents a certain level of energy and a certain level of enthusiasm about, of all things, Microsoft Excel. And she does that purposefully. But she tested a few presentation methods first until she found the one that worked well for her. So that's what you need to do. Definitely a sample/prototype in it is exactly what we're talking about there. Then educate stakeholders. So remember how earlier I said, you know, there's different types of learning and there's different types of microlearning. And if we don't define what it is, we can get confused about the semantics. Well, I guarantee your stakeholders probably have a different definition of microlearning than you do. And if you don't agree on the terminology and what microlearning is for this particular project, then you're going to have disconnects. And so what you really want to do is clearly define what microlearning means in this instance and what you're trying to accomplish. And then find your champions. There's got to be people inside the organization that are excited about what you want to accomplish. So leverage those people, especially if they're in operations of the business, because operations folks are really going to help make this happen. We're there to support the organization. So make sure that you start with what you want to do there. And Zolt, to your point, yeah, don't start with IT, right? Start with the learning outcome, the behavioral outcome. We in learning are in the business of changing behaviors. And so we want to focus on what behavior are we trying to change and trying to do that. So yeah, absolutely doing that.
Awesome. Well, I think we're at time, but we were open to questions. We did offer up our slides as well. So on the last two slides past our fun guy here at the end are a lot of articles Karl and I have written. There's a great podcast in there. And the final takeaway that we will give you is we created a summation that's actually a microlearning tool for you all. It's in the chat box. And if you pull it up, it is a pensive piece of microlearning to prompt you to think about today's presentation and how you can move some of these ideas and thoughts forward for you and your organization's initiatives.
Okay, I'm gonna bump your sharing off because I'm keeping us on time, but I also want to just engage in some of the dialogue. Cause that honestly, for let's see some more emojis. Come on, folks, keep them going. Like pump the emojis up. Cause really this was and again, we can have some dialogue and have some questions around this as they come through the chat. But I think your point about this, sometimes I've seen in the industry where we just get hung up on, do we microlearn or do we not? And it's like, well, that's the wrong question to be asking. I think, Karl, to your point of we need to think about this more broadly of what is the employee experience? What are they doing? Where are they? What is that? How do we reach them then? And is microlearning a component of that? Absolutely. But how we deliver on that, that's going to depend situationally. So it's about having the tools in our arsenal and then figuring out when do we deploy them.
Exactly. I mean, sometimes, you know, a job aid, to go back to that, is the perfect tool. And sometimes it's the worst tool ever.
So right. Yeah. A job aid can be terrible. Like some people are like, let's turn everything into a job aid. Bad idea.
Bad idea. Exactly. Exactly. And so, you know, when you think of the term learning experience designer, that's what that means, right? You take a look at the whole system in which the employee is performing and figure out what's the right combination to get them from point A to point B, or to maintain their behavior, or to maintain what they're trying to accomplish. And so sometimes instructor-led training works really well, sometimes it doesn't, but it never should be in a vacuum or by itself. I love the whole kind of multiverse of the Marvel universe, right? They've got TV shows, they've got comic books, they've got movies, they have movies that are related to each other, they have movies that aren't really related to each other. All of that is what makes that whole thing work and click, and learning should be the same way. We need to think about the whole, and we can focus on one thing: what is the outcome or outcomes that we want of these employees? And I think part of the, you know, if you look at the great resignation that's happening or the laydown in China, the whole idea is that people are not feeling a holistic picture of right. what their organization is doing or want them to accomplish. So without purpose and without meaning, just kind of doing the same task, you lose why you're doing something. And yeah. we in learning and development need to reinforce why that. The one thing I like about learning and development is, microlearning can reinforce this, is we're the keeper of the culture, right? Yeah. We might not create the culture, but when we train new employees, when we train existing employees, when we talk about new policies and new procedures from a training perspective, we are conveying the culture of the organization. Then we may convey a great culture, or we might be like Enron and you know, do a culture that's corrupted.
Well, and we have an opportunity to really shape the employee experience. When we really think about this, the satisfaction of an employee, I mean, a lot of times we have massive power in being able to influence this, but we have to think about what do they really need? And I think that's an important part. Sometimes it's easy to get caught up in what we want, what we like, instead of, okay, that's not really how we should be approaching this. We should be approaching this in terms of what do they need? And then now, how do we back into what do we have in our arsenal to be able to reach that?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. All right. Well, one more series of emojis, everybody. Like, let's show some love here for what we got with this one, because that was fantastic. And I'm gonna tie this off to one of the most popular questions that keeps popping up in the Q&A, which is this going to be recorded? And the answer is yes, it's absolutely gonna be recorded so that you can go back and reference this and check out the examples. They've shared a bunch of resources. I know the 7TAPS team is sending out a newsletter with all the different resources. So I just wanna say, thank you for making the time, for being here, for answering all the questions. And if you stick around for a bit and go through the chat, by all means, you know, I think there's more questions than I think we could ever get through. We could probably dedicate the rest of the afternoon to just the Q&A. But I love the perspective you brought, which is think about this holistically. Don't go find a new tool and then be like, let's make everything that. That is not how to do this right. What's to do it right is to learn the whole portfolio and say, how do we bring this to life and transform the experience?
Right.
Awesome.